Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig and from viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight, where the Ruckettes fight tooth and nail and sometimes tongue in cheek over the news of the day and the trends of the times. Well, think of it as downsizing with an upscale cost. American royal officials, along with some civic leaders, including Crosby Kemper Jr. and his son Mariner, are calling for the demolition of Kemper Arena and the construction of a new, smaller facility for equestrian and agricultural events. The cost is not small, an estimated $70 million. The senior Kemper, whose influence and money were instrumental in building the arena, said it's now a relic of the past. Mariner Kemper said it is unrealistic to think Kansas City can support the arena and the Sprint Center, which opened in 2007. The Kempers say they will contribute to and spearhead an effort to raise $10 million from the private sector. Only leaves $60 million, Yale. Where does that come from?
Well, it's better not come from the public. There was a great editorial in the Kansas City Star this morning about this topic. In fact, I'd urge you to go read it. But it basically said,
I already did.
Good for
you. I wonder who wrote it.
It basically said that there's a $70 million tag, as you said, and about $20 million of it probably could come from the public. City owes $10 million in the bond. City's going to have to fulfill that requirement. If there's a cost to raise a city-owned building, well, the city probably ought to do it. And there are also some expenses that the current American Royal buildings down there the city could do. But for the Kempers to come out and say, well, we'll raise $10 million, okay, that's fine for them. You're going to need at least another $40 million from the private sector. That's where the American Royal people, and that includes the Kemper, come in. They can go out there. They need to do that. They get to get private money for it, and here's why. Getting rid of Kemper is not a high priority for Kansas City right now. I mean, keeping it there and you know, for the Royal into the future and leaving the doors open cost $1 million a year. That's not chicken feed, but it's also not $70 million. So, you know, keeping it there and keeping it open is like option B. I don't mind the idea of tearing down Kemper. I don't mind the idea of putting up a new ag center, but it needs to be mostly privately funded. We've got $2.5 billion worth of sewer stuff that our water rates are going up 15% a year to pay for. We've got $1 billion worth of streets, roads, bridges, sidewalks, all other water lines, you know, all those kind of things that need to be fixed. Those are high priorities in neighborhoods, and we have a great arena at Sprint Center. If we get rid of Kemper, I think it's okay. Replace it with a mostly privately funded building. Last thing, real quickly, American Royal people back in 1988. Said, hey, we'll raise some money for the new American Royal Complex. City puts in 20, private puts in 5. Well, okay, fine. When it all worked out, American Royal people that went over budget $9 million. Public picked up $8 million of it, the private sector picked up 1. It's time for the private sector to pay back and to raise the money for the new building.
My recollection may be inaccurate, but at the time the Sprint Center was being talked about, weren't these questions raised about yes. What does that mean to the Kemper Arena and its future? And yes. Do we need two arenas in Kansas City?
Well, I think part of that was we promised to keep it open for the Royal.
Yeah.
Yes. At this cost.
Which is why it was built, as I recall. It was to keep the American Royal, to house the American
Royal.
Well,
the words used were it was going to be for the dirt events. One of my favorite phrases.
I like those.
The dirt events. Well, there was something about this announcement that I really liked, the Kemper family coming forward and saying, time to move on. They're not attached to this building. And as we discussed a few weeks ago on Ruckus, no one's going to be crying when the bulldozers, you know, start up down there in the West Bottom. It's been okay. It serves some purpose, but it's just not a building people are emotionally attached to. Secondly, the drawing of the potential new building and its purpose is a very exciting concept, and one I think could really move the agricultural center of Kansas City's economic development side of the effort here and the economic
and we can't forget
forward.
The importance of agriculture,
absolutely
equestrian
not.
Activities
it's
and agribusiness
important.
To the Kansas City region.
Be a 21st century building for a 21st century economic part of our community.
Great idea. We talk about the identity of Kansas City. we have an identity, and I'm all for this entrepreneurial capital of America idea. It's a great idea. But we are, in fact, the capital of this agricultural empire that sprawls out over Nebraska and Iowa and Kansas and Oklahoma. And that identity is number one, never going away, nor should it, and we should hang on to it. Now, I'm with Yale about how much of this should be public and how much this should be private money. I don't know exactly what the number is, but the private sector is going to have to dig down on this. But we're talking about the five big ideas, one of which is this symposium on animal health.
Right.
This is a place where that could be centered.
Exactly.
I will tell you this, and a caveat here, my public disclosure, my wife owns and shows horses. They keep that Hale Arena pretty busy, and they could keep it occupied 51 weeks a year. And we are pulling events right now from Springfield and Columbia, a lot of the small towns, because we have an air-conditioned, fairly modern facility, and the old ones out there across the Midwest are drying up and blowing away. There's an opportunity to keep this building occupied year-round with events.
Well, yeah,
that will pay some
money. That's what the Kempers were saying. They could keep that busy five, six, seven nights a week. It seems, though, Gwen, the last straw was moving the rodeo from Kemper to the Sprint Center.
Yeah, that was
literally. I mean, that seemed to be
the final blow, right?
If we tear Kemper down and build it?
Yeah. I don't know. It sounds like they won't have a contract with him. But real quick, your point that agriculture is still a big thing here in Kansas City? Great. Then let all the private sector people who benefit from agriculture step forward and put some money into it.
With some money. I'm not arguing.
The spokesman for the American Royal was quoted in the Star as saying it contributed $70 million annually to the local economy.
That's the Royal stuff.
There you go.
Agriculture is even bigger.
Oh, agribusiness would be much bigger than that.
And I just hope that the Star will take the same position about this downtown hotel when that comes up.
Well, heaven.
That's a good point.
There's all kinds of
green points. I agree with you.
Exhibition and all kinds of very special events.
We have to move on to another topic. There may not be a shred of evidence because the evidence may have been shredded. Johnson County's first criminal prosecution of Planned Parenthood, initiated when Phil Klein was district attorney, is at a standstill because crucial records in the case have been destroyed by the state. Kansas officials say the action was routine. The case involving 23 felony counts of falsifying abortion reports may hinge on those destroyed documents. The executive director of Kansans for Life, Mary Kay Culp, called the incident unbelievable and alleges the shredding was done to protect the abortion industry. Does she have a reasonable point, Woody?
Well, that depends on the evidence in the record. And as I understand it, it seems to be this. I noticed in their statement, the Kansas Department of Health and Environment or whatever, that they said the present case was not pending at that time. That is true. Planned Parenthood had not been charged with anything at that point. It is, however, not a complete statement of the facts. Back in 2004, Klein, as Attorney General, started this investigation. There was a report that the Kansas Department, KDHE, this agency, has to give, I think, every year, on all the abortions in Kansas. And among other things, it shows how many of them were on girls under 15 years of age. Obviously, that raises an issue of whether there's been child abuse resulting in harm. If there has, as Bishop Finn can tell you, there are laws on mandatory reporting of such things. So the question is, were there 166 reports or anything like that of child sexual abuse? Well, turns out there, from abortion clinics, there were only four. So back to KDHE goes Klein and says, I need to see the backup records of the report. They say, hell no. Big fight in the courts. This is all taking place in the summer of 2004. And finally in 2004, they are ordered to produce the records. They produce the records to the court and to Klein. And the names of the abortion clinics are coded. So all there is a code. Klein says, give me the code. Then they fight over that. The judge says, you got to give them the code. When you get the code, the vast majority of these abortions on girls under 15 are done by either Planned Parenthood or Tiller's Clinic in Wichita. And so now we're in late summer 2004. Believe me, KDHE knows there's a criminal investigation going on because they've been fighting all about it. And so then when it all becomes public, when Tiller and Planned Parenthood try to quash subpoenas to them, and the Supreme Court schedules it in late February of 2005, it becomes public, and it's all anybody's talking about around here. And at that point, KDHE starts destroying records as a routine matter.
And I believe did not tell Klein or the
court.
There was no reason to.
It's the original evidence.
The simple fact of this case is that it was filed in 2007, and that these records that Phil Klein at the time didn't bother to check to see if they were around. I mean, if you're filing a case and it depends upon records, and by the way, he didn't win any of these cases.
Let me ask a question. This was filed by Klein, but continued by the current district attorney, not someone who could be described as an abortion zealot.
He apparently just looked into this fact a short while ago.
Apparently he thought the cases were appropriate to continue.
Well, just because Phil Klein goes away doesn't mean the case goes away.
Well, I know, but there's prosecutorial discretion.
So these records were routinely, as all state records are, were routinely shredded 2 years before he filed the case. And if that's the case, you have no leg to stand on. I mean, Woody, this was an effort, one more effort on Phil Klein to take after Planned
Parenthood. No, you have a leg to stand on because there are copies of the records. And if you can establish the chain
records.
Of custody. By the way, Paul Morrison, when he became attorney general, took the records that he took to Virginia and took to a garage somewhere, and one of the reasons why he was about to be disbarred. The prosecuting attorney now in Johnson County has copies of these records, which were given to the court, and he got copies of them. And Paul Morrison tried to get those back when he became attorney
general. Because they are the personal records of women.
No, they're not. There's no mention of the victims in any of these. These reports contain no mention of the patient or
they were destroyed 2 years before the crime.
Let's go over here to the other side of the panel.
Modern side.
Even if this is all on the up and up, and the state has done nothing wrong, does it not give the impression of impropriety to the casual observer?
Yes, it does. This case also reminds me of why I'm so glad Phil Klein's gone. I mean, we can talk abortion to ad nauseum and blue in the face. It's not going to really change a lot. Abortions will continue. They are legal until, they try to get rid of them in Kansas, I guess, as they are in other states. I think if you just look, you ask the average person, does it look bad that the state shred the records? Yes, it does.
Yeah. And Gwen, the judge says he sees no conspiracy to destroy the records. Does that suggest what the outcome of the case might be?
Well, I agree with Mary. I think, when were the records shredded? Was it a part of, was it a routine process? They were shredded before the case was filed? And that seems to be where the judge is leaning, so I agree.
Well, we shall see. When political junkies, such as the five people here, talk about the November election, they are probably talking about November 2012. But there is one this November in the area that deserves our attention. Jackson and Clay County voters will be asked to approve a 1/8-cent sales tax to fund improvements at the Kansas City Zoo. Jackson and Clay counties only? What happened to Cass and Platte? Weren't they part of the original deal, Mary?
Well, there are all kinds of deals with regard to this new tax about to be levied if people are about to choose a new tax in Jackson and Clay County. Well, the people and the elected officials in Platte County and Cass County said no. We're not going to do this. And they have all manner of reasons for doing so. And I have no idea their personal reasons for that. But here's how it's structured. This is an amazingly complex new tax proposal for the people of Jackson and Clay County. The city zoo is an asset of the city of Kansas City, Missouri. Currently, they fund it to the tune of $3.4 million this year, scheduled to go up to $4.1 million next year. Now, a group got together, friends of the zoo and their friends, went to the legislature, said, we're not going to do this through the city. We're going to put together a sort of a county thing, and we're going to create a whole new little zoo government called the Zoo District Authority. And on that board that will run this $14 million a year, by the way, the city of Kansas City, Missouri will not have a voice. There will be no one on that board from the city of Kansas City, Missouri. It'll have friends of the zoo on there that they'll elect themselves. It'll have somebody the county legislature and the county in Jackson and Clay have on there.
The zoo director.
And the director of the zoo
member of the parks board from Kansas City.
This is a this is a tax authority that's just a brand new idea. It's, I think it's pretty strange. Also, Johnson County, even though the zoo is an enormous regional attraction, Johnson County and all the others, we don't not going to have to charge ourselves this tax, or Wyandotte, or any other county around.
But this was a decision by the people who planned this, and I believe they had to get
it
state
was.
Legislative approval, did they
not?
They
went not? To the what legislature.
A special district
got, lobbied, got the they, bill passed, yeah. then brought it back, yeah. got the Jackson County Legislature to put it on the ballot, then went up and got Clay, and it's a strange bird, I think.
I should have checked into this, but yes. I figured Yale will know the yes. answer, so I don't need to bother. What if one county passes it and the other does not?
Jackson needs to pass it, according to the state, and they're the biggest county. Well, let's strip away all the...
So if Jackson passes it, it goes into effect?
Yes, yes.
That's true.
Just in Jackson County?
Yes, in Jackson County. It's just like the bi-state in that regard, okay, that you have to have the counties approve it.
Well,
let's strip away the, you know, the conspiratorial theory by the
There's no conspiratorial
here.
Theory, Yale. Come on.
Play
it straight, Yale,
for once. We're in bad economic times now.
We are.
And they're asking for a tax increase. So let's look at whether voters will be able to vote on it, and they'll be able to decide, well, 8% sales tax, do I want to build a bigger zoo, better zoo? Now, unlike the sports complex votes, which were tax increases that were approved by Jackson County residents, you'll actually get something for your money if you're a regular folk citizen. You'll get the reduced rates of admission, you'll get four free days, you'll get free, you know, if you have children, they'll get to go there for free on school trips. So you're actually getting something for the money. Now, in addition to that, all the people in Johnson County that Mary's whining about, they get a better zoo. Now, they have to pay full price for it because they're not paying the tax, but they'll get more animals, more exhibits, and a year-round zoo.
Here's the thing. I am not
No, I don't need to be interrupted by you since you don't know what you're talking about in this case, Mary.
I didn't interrupt you today, and you can't interrupt me.
Well, yeah, no, you did interrupt me today. That's the problem. Well, I put some facts in there.
There's no conspiracy here, Mike.
Mary, hang on for just a second.
One thing about the zoological authority that everybody seems to be so concerned about. The Friends of the Zoo run the place right now. It's a private management group. Guess what the zoo has been at its best in the last 10 years when it's been privately managed? I mean, getting the city out of the deal and getting the Parks Department out of the deal of running the zoo was great for the Parks Department and great for the
final.
Yeah, let me just respond. I, of course, my best friends are involved in trying to promote this.
My best friends are animals.
Excluded. There is no conspiracy here, but this is a...
Oh, good.
Yale wrote the editorial, I assume.
Another great editorial in the Star.
You know, if you just can just hold off, Yale.
Sorry.
There's no conspiracy, and I'm not whining about anything. The people of Johnson County are not whining that they don't have to contribute a dime.
You're saying it would be a good idea for a measure to be offered to Johnson County at some time.
The perfect opportunity would have been, since the city of Kansas City is now involved in its municipal revenue review with Susan Stanton at its head. This was what Sly James had in mind. Get our act together and then start raising
taxes. By the way,
we have to press on here. If someone invites you to one of the hot spots in town, be sure to carefully check the destination before saying yes. Hot spots is the term now being used by law enforcement to target those areas where violent crimes are most likely. According to Police Chief Daryl Forte, the four areas encompass 13 square miles, where half of the city's homicides and 43% of the non-fatal shootings have taken place since 2009. Chief Forte says this is just a first step. Is it a good first step, Gwen?
Absolutely. It's focused. He's not. He's using existing resources to address the problem. And with 50% of the homicides occurring within this 13 square mile area, and 42% of assaults occurring there, to zero in on that area, maybe we can see some measurable impact on violent crime. I spoke with the chief and asked him, so this is a great first step, but then what's next? What does he see coming in the future to address crime, particularly around the weapons? You know, I think we need to do something to get these weapons out of the community. And so he said that they have a weapons recovery strategy that they are also implementing at this time and hope to build upon, which is having their specialized units, their SWAT teams, their traffic officers, when they make stops and they're wanting to, if you are in any way suspicious, you're going to get searched. They're going to try to recover weapons, and then if they do a casual traffic stop, they want to begin to build relationships with people in the community. The officers are going to be giving them their cards, saying, you know, we're really trying to crack down on violent crime. We need your help. And that's a positive step in building real police community relationships. His other strategy with regard to police community relationships, because that's something we talk about, but have we ever really seen it happen in a mm-hmm. way where you can say we're having the kind of impact that we want? And so his objective is to get into dialogue with the community and ask them, how do you see us working more effectively with you? So that when we roll up, and he said, and this was, I thought, a very interesting perspective, because my view is that the community has not been as supportive of law enforcement as they should be with regard to giving up information. A crime uh-huh. happens, three or four people or 40 or 50 people witness a crime, and then this no snitching thing. Well, he said that, well, shame on the police uh-huh. if they roll up on a crime in a community that they've served all these years and nobody says anything because the relationships
are fractured. Can he do things that no other police chief could have done because he's an African-American male?
Well, you know, I think that race...
I mean, without being accused of racism.
Well, race may be the factor, but I think it has much more to do with his approach to law enforcement and recognizing that it stems from looking at the data, zeroing in on these hot spots, and then working very intentionally on those relationships and doing some things differently.
Taking a scientific look,
working with the people in the communities to help them figure this out as a team, as opposed to just rolling in when there's a crime.
Right. Yeah. And Gwen, I amen to a lot of what you said. The chief was in yesterday to the editorial board and was very specific on a lot of stuff, very blunt, gave some of the same answers he certainly did to you. But on this race question, he said, hey, I'm not the chief of Black Kansas City,
right,
and, you know, I'm going to try to... He has a good law enforcement record. But specifically, a colleague told me that at the board meeting the other day, Board Commissioner Alvin Brooks, you know, Black man, said to Daryl Forte, hey, you know, you get some blowback from people in the community about how you're doing this crackdown that you talked about, I've got your back. Because I think it's not just the Black community that wants to stop violent crime. Everybody does, but I think your question is right, that he can, and I will say, I do think he can do some stuff that some other, you know, white chief will be able to do.
I didn't cite him, but I'm just paraphrasing something Mayor James said yesterday.
Mm-hmm. But let me tell you what.
Because I said, what about the new chief? And I think this was off the air. I don't think it was confidential. He said he'll be able to do things that others have not been able to do simply because of who he is.
Because of who he is.
Yeah.
Yes, he's a Black man, but because of who he is.
He's also a good chief.
Because he's a good chief. And he has good relationships that other chiefs haven't had, irrespective of race.
That he spent years doing.
Well, also because he was hired from within, and he knows this.
One of the benefits of hiring
from a carpetbagger or an interloper.
One of the benefits of hiring.
We need our homegrown people sometimes.
And now,
homegrown. Right?
And now, it's time for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckheads praise or pan people and events in the news, starting tonight with Yale.
Oh, good. Well, I'll just go right to Chief Forte. When he came in yesterday, you know, usually when Chief Corbin would come in, he'd bring in five or eight or his whole entourage. It was just Forte himself. He said things like, well, the police department has been arrogant. Words to my ears, because the police have been arrogant in rejecting insurance policy and rejecting changes that they should do. But he was also a defender of the police department and saying, hey, we've got a lot of bright people here. I've got a lot of smart young and old people that can carry out my plan for improving Kansas City and fighting crime. I think Forte gets it, that he's going to have a staff that works behind him and gets a job done in Kansas City. Good start.
For those of you who've watched Ruckus a couple of weeks in a row, you may have noticed that odd couple, Planned Parenthood and the Catholic Diocese of St. Joseph, Kansas City, have trouble with the same law, the law on the mandatory reporting of sexual abuse of young people. They both face this difficulty. Gene Petersbaker, the prosecuting attorney in Jackson County, is fitting a noose for the bishop of the diocese on mandatory reporting. those of us who would like to see Planned Parenthood closed down are glad to note that that noose will fit them perfectly once she's stretched the law just far enough. Thank you.
I'm toasting the redistricting committee for the city of Kansas City, Missouri, who has put forth a very good redistricting map for the city council to approve. And I want to commend the coalition of the African American and Latino community under the leadership of under the vision of Congressman Emanuel Cleaver, who put that group together to mend fences that were fractured during the last redistricting process.
I want to toast the life and legacy of two really remarkable women, Marty Singleton and Betty Harvey Slegman, both passed away this last week. Great leaders in our community, not always out in the forefront, but mentors and role models for women especially. They were incredibly intense and dedicated and faithful women, particularly on women's issues. And we will miss them both. Their activism and their voices were strong and faithful, and they will be missed.
All right, quick toast to some of Congressman Emanuel Cleaver's staff members both in Washington and Kansas City, who, for the first time in nearly 5 years, managed to arrange for Cleaver to join Scott Parks and me for a radio interview. Cleaver says this will be the first of many, and I hope he's right. In the way of news, Cleaver told us he is running for re-election next year and would not be disappointed if he's ultimately succeeded in the House by Jackson County Executive Mike Sanders. That's Ruckus for this week. For details about the public roasting and toasting of the Ruckettes at Californos in Westport, go to kcpt.org and be sure to join Nick Haynes Friday evening at 7:30 for Kansas City Week in Review. And now on behalf of the Ruckettes, our producer Sean Holmes, I'm Mike Shannon. Thank you very much for watching and good night.
Production underwriting for Ruckus has been made possible in part by the generous contributions from Fred and Lou Hartwig, and from viewers like you. Thank you.